Hello everyone, I'm Dr. Matlab. Here is the second part of my course, which aims to learn you how to apply a discrete time controller in a microcontroller. Before continuing, just a quick note that I changed the logo of my YouTube channel, as you see here. Okay, now we will resume our course with this second part. Are you ready? Let's go. Okay, I remind you of the point at which we have finished our first part of the course. We have arrived at this point. How to translate our transfer function to recurrence equations? We said that we will propose some procedure with 5 steps. In the second part, we will start to explain the first step of our procedure. Okay, now the first point in this step that we have to obtain the factored form of our transfer function. Okay, so we have to obtain this factored form with the gain k and the factored form of this transfer function. That means that the numerator is a product of polynomials of degree 1, where we have the zeros z1, z2, until zm, and similarly for the denominator, which has 2p, a product of polynomials of degree 1, where we have the poles p1, p2 until pn. Okay, in fact, this is the general factored form of our transfer function, and we will continue in this step to improve this factored form. Now we will distinguish between two cases. The first case that the controller is already given by the standard form. So we have to switch to the factored form. Now, in order to show you how to do that, we will propose some numerical examples. We take this example where we have the standard form of our transfer function. So we have to switch to this factored form. As you see, we have here a numerator of degree 2. That's why we have here a product of two polynomials of degree 1. And you can see that we have a denominator of degree 4. That's why we have a product of 4 polynomials of degree 1. And that's the general factored form. Now we have to find the value of the gain k. You can notice that if I multiply these two polynomials, I can get a standard form where the coefficient of the first term is equal to 1. And similarly for the denominator, where the coefficient of the term with the greatest degree is equal to 1. As you notice here, for the denominator, the coefficient of the term with the greatest degree is equal to 1. So no problem with the denominator. But for the numerator, the coefficient of the term with the greatest degree is equal to 2. So the numerator has to be divided by 2. And we can see that the value of the gain k is equal to 2. Now we have to find the zeros and the poles. For that, we have to find the roots of the numerator and the roots of the denominator. In order to find the roots of a polynomial, we can use the function roots in MATLAB. This function roots, which takes as an argument a vector of coefficients from the coefficient of the term with the greatest degree to the coefficient of the term with the least degree. We note that for the standard form, the numerator and the denominator, each polynomial is ordered in descending powers of z. So to find the roots of the numerator, we can put the vector of the coefficients as follows. We start with 1, then minus 0.5, then 0.06. Then we can find with this function the zeros, which are 0.3 and 0.2. Okay, now similarly, we can find the poles for the denominator. So now we have the zeros and the poles, so we can find the factored form of our transfer function. We can take another example with this transfer function with the standard form. So we have to switch to this factored form. We can see that we have a numerator of degree 2. That's why we have a product of two polynomials of degree 1. And we have a denominator of degree 2. That's why we have a product of two polynomials of degree 1. We can notice that the coefficient of the first term of the numerator is equal to 2, and the coefficient of the first term of the denominator is equal to 3. That's why we divide the numerator by 2 and we divide the denominator by 3. So the value of the gain k is equal to 2/3. Now we have to find the zeros and the poles, so we can always use the function roots in MATLAB. For the numerator, we can put the vector of coefficients as explained before, and we can find the zeros. But for the denominator, we have to pay attention to something, that we have to put all the coefficients, even we have coefficients which are equal to zero. So for our denominator, we cannot put 1, then immediately minus 0.25. So for this vector of coefficients, which is ordered in considering the descending powers of z, we put 1, then 0, then minus 0.25. Okay, now we can apply the function roots and we find the poles. Now we have the zeros and the poles, so we can easily write down our factored form. Okay, in fact, we can use another method in order to find the factored form. Suppose that the controller, which is in standard form, is an object in MATLAB, as you see here. So in this case, we can use the function cpk, where we can put our controller as an argument of the function that gives us the factored form. As you see here in MATLAB, we can put our controller in parentheses as an argument of the function zbk, and that gives us our factored form. Okay, until now we have dealt the case where the controller is already given by the standard form, and we have shown how to find the factored form. Now suppose that the controller is already given by the factored form. Okay, that's very good. Now the question is, why it's not good to consider the standard form? And in particular, if we have already the factored form, why is not it good to switch to the standard form? Okay, I let you think about it and comment on it, then we can discuss. In fact, I will make a video apart in order to show you mathematically why it's not good to switch to the standard form. Why, if we have already the controller in the factored form, it's not good to switch to the standard form. Here is a quick example where we have already the factored form, so we must not switch to the standard form. So we must always consider the factored form for application in a microcontroller. Okay? Now we will continue in this step, and with numerical examples, we will continue to improve the factored form because we have not finished yet. We can take this example. As you see here, we have two complex conjugate roots, so we cannot consider this factored form for numerical application. So what to do? In fact, in place of these two polynomials of degree 1, we put the corresponding polynomial of degree 2. Now, how to find this polynomial of degree 2? Quite simply, we multiply these two polynomials of degree 1, and then we find this polynomial. Finally, the considered form is the following. As you see here, we have a polynomial of degree 1 because we have a real root. And similarly for this polynomial and this polynomial. But we have here two complex conjugate roots. That's why we have here a polynomial of degree 2. Okay? We can take another example. As you see here, we have two complex conjugate roots. And we have here two complex conjugate roots. That's why for this considered form, we have here a polynomial of degree 2, and we have here a polynomial of degree 2. Okay, so here's the second point in this step. If we have a real root, we consider a polynomial of degree 1, but if we have two complex conjugate roots, we consider a polynomial of degree 2. And we can have several polynomials of degree 2. That depends how much we have complex conjugate roots. Okay? We continue in this step with numerical examples in order to improve the factored form. Suppose now with this example we have this factored form. but we have here an integrator z over z minus 1. In fact, we cannot leave this factored form like that. We have to put the integrator right after the gain key. Then the rest will be put after. Finally, we will have this factored form where we have the gain k, then we have the integrator, if we have an integrator, then the rest. Okay, here is the last point in this step. Finally, the factored form which will be considered is the following, where we have the gain k, then the integrator, if we have an integrator, then the rest, where n of z is a product of polynomials of degree 1 if we have real roots, and polynomials of degree 2 if we have complex conjugate roots, and similarly for d of z. Okay, here's the first step where we have to obtain this factored form. Okay, I will stop here for this video, and I ask you please to wait for the new videos where I will explain the following steps of the procedure. And please don't forget to subscribe to my channel. That will support the channel and will allow you to not miss any video I upload soon. Okay, thanks for your attention. Merci.